It is warm in here, isn't it?
Yes.
Can we adjust the thermostat? I keep having people tell me it's warm in here.
The heat was on.
The heat was on. Oh. I think there's a song about that. Good morning, church. Sorry, I was doing this and not paying attention to the time. I don't usually have this particular part of the job, but it's a wonderful part. I have a couple of pieces of paper in my hand that are colored. Don't know if you have them or not. The yellow one is the one for Lent, first week of Lent. This one was one that we didn't get passed out very well at the Ash Wednesday service. These are opportunities for you to meditate through the season of Lent, as the stewardship committee has decided that we will emphasize prayer throughout the season of Lent. You know, when we agree to join the church, it's prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness. Well, this is the prayer piece, and every week you're going to get one of these that gives you a prayer opportunity for each day. And on the back, there's a couple of quizzes. They got creative this year. So you can do the quiz and see how you do. I haven't even looked at it yet, so interesting. In your bulletin, you'll see several things that are happening this week on the calendar of events on the back. So please take note of those things that apply to you and your family. Mark your calendar if there's something you need to be a part of. I want you to mark your calendar for next Sunday. As you see in this box, Jeannette Collier's party. We're celebrating that she has been in this church on this staff for 30 years. Oh, she's sick today. I'm glad she's not sick next week. I was going to turn to her and say, Jeannette, take a bow. But anyway, plan to be with us next week. Jeannette is Irish. St. Patrick's Day. She's also some German, but she loves potato soup, so guess what we're having next Sunday? Potato soup. So come and join us. Also below that in the yellow box, you'll see we have an opportunity to bless the administrators, the staff, the faculty across the street at the middle school. Anybody know what Pi Day is? It's kind of new, and I'm not good at math. I'm so bad at math, you don't even want to know. But this is an opportunity for you to bake a pie, bring it here Tuesday morning, we'll take it across the street for you. The school would like to treat their teachers, their counselors, their bus drivers, not the students, sorry students. Oh, it's Thursday. Oh, thank you, Deborah. It is Thursday. So Thursday morning, have that pie ready to deliver across the street, bring it here so you don't have, they don't want 100 people descending upon the school. So bring it here and we'll deliver it for you Thursday morning. Thank you so much, Deborah, for helping me out. Now, welcome to all of those who are here, now that everyone seems to be kind of seated. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we are so blessed. And we have a gift for you at our welcome desk out in the foyer. So be sure and stop by there before you leave and grab that gift. If all of you would be so kind as to sign the registration pad that's in the pew rack beside you, it's a red folder. Thank you, Rick. And if you would sign that, if you have a prayer concern, great place to put it because we pray over these every week. If you have a new address, a new email address, any of that sort of thing, that's another good place to put it. So please be sure and sign that and pass it down your pew, and you never know, you might meet a new friend, okay? I think that's all I have. I'm sorry? Oh, yes, I'm sorry, Tommy. The brown bag breakfast is this Saturday morning, and Bob, raise your hand. Bob's going to talk to everybody who comes about the recovery of the astronauts as he flew the helicopter and picked them up off the ocean. So that'll be an interesting program, and I know you'll want to be a part of that. It's a men's brown bag breakfast. I think you have to be able to say it to attend. And Tommy always says ladies are invited, and I kind of do that because men really should have their own thing. But I'll turn the other way if ladies want to come, or if Bob wants to just talk to the ladies later, that would be cool too. Okay? So let us begin our time of worship together.
Lord is present and where he is his glory.
Amen. Friends, would you stand as you're able, and let's do the opening prayer together. Let us pray. God, our guide and our protector, as we gather today in your holy house, open our minds and souls and hearts, that we may be inclined to hear the gentle direction of your Spirit in our lives. Help us follow you as you lead us to the land you have created for us, where we may dwell with you and in you. Amen. And now let us take a moment and greet one another in the name of Jesus Christ. Singing. As you're being seated, let me invite the children forward with Sarah for the children's time.
Good morning. How are you? Did y'all have a good week at school?
Yeah.
Good. Did anything exciting happen? No? Something sad happened? I'm sorry. I hope it's better. Well, I'm glad most of you had a good week. So today is a special Sunday. Can anyone guess why it's a special Sunday?
Because it's donut day.
No, it's donut day? Well, we have donuts every week. But that's okay. Donuts are awesome. The Sunday after Ash Wednesday. So it's also known as the first Sunday in Lent. So we had Ash Wednesday on, we had the service, and we put what, a cross on us? On your forehead, some of you got the cross. And the cross actually represents the beginning of Lent and the 40 days before Easter. And we actually have the Ash Wednesday service to kind of reflect and repent and see if we're doing okay on our walk with Jesus, to kind of ask forgiveness for things that we need to work on. And then for Lent, we actually do something kind of special too. Does anybody know what that is? No, you can, it's okay. You can either give something up for 40 days or you can pick up a new habit. So, like, I gave up Facebook for 6 weeks, so I could use the time I spend on Facebook to pray to the God or use the time to read my Bible. You gave up video games? That's really good. I know that was hard. Did anybody else give up anything? What? Playing outside? You gave up playing outside? That's a big one. Thank you.
I'm doing having less screen time.
Less screen time? That's a good one. You have one?
You can play with your brothers.
You can play with your brothers? That's a good one. Add something. Yes? Not play with your toys? It's 6 weeks. Not 2 weeks. 6 weeks. 40 days. So you can think about that one. So when you think of Lent, we all think of a pretzel, right? You're like, oh, yeah, Lent, the pretzel. Nobody? Nobody's like, yes, I get a pretzel? Really? So nobody knows that Lent is associated with a pretzel?
No.
What is? It's the legend of the Lenten pretzel. So you see, a long, long time ago, there were some monks. And they knew that they had to give up something for 40 days. But they really liked bread. So they tried to figure out a way to make bread without milk or eggs. Thank you. And so they came up with this unique dough that they use, and they turned it into what we now know is a pretzel. So, like, all the bread that they made would just, like, fall on the ground. Like, they had these pieces of bread that would fall on the ground, and then they picked them up, these pieces of bread, and they put them together, and they formed what we now know today as a pretzel. And thanks to Pastor Tommy, he brought us all pretzels, so we're all going to have pretzels in kids' church in a little bit. So to celebrate, but they all thought that the pretzel, the inside part, looked like when you fold your hands like this, everybody do their hands like this across their heart, that they would use that and that they would pray to God. And so a pretzel reminded them of the importance of prayer to their Heavenly Father. So you didn't know that a pretzel could actually remind you to pray, did you? That's pretty cool, isn't it? So as we think about Lent and what we're grateful for and what we're going to give up in our lives, just always remember that the number one person is who?
God.
Jesus. And always remember to pray. So let's pray this morning and ask God to help us. Dear Lord, thank you for loving us.
Thank you for giving
us
reminders of your love,
even in the form
of a pretzel.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
What do we say?
Yay, Jesus.
As the children are leaving and the ushers come forward, church, will you join me in a prayer for our offering? God, I thank you so much for the chance to give. God, I ask you to bless our hearts as we give. I ask you to bless these gifts to do your work, to bring your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Jesus walked this lonesome valley. He had to walk.
As the ushers come forward, we always like to think of something we're thankful for. And I'm thankful for the chance to get to know God a little bit closer through the pilgrimage that, 18 members of our church went through. And for them, for the ability to share this so that we can also grow closer to God. And whenever I'm thankful, I like to say, thanks be to God. Would you join me in a moment of prayer? God, I thank you so much that we can find you in all sorts of things. That you become present in things as small as pretzels, things as big as trips over the ocean. God, we thank you that we can find you when we open up our Bible and read your word, that we can find you when we sing the songs of the church, and that we can just spend a moment to rest our soul with you. God, as we move on, I heard the news about the plane crash that just happened in the middle of the early service, God. Something about all of those souls and the 33 different countries that are grieving loss. God, be with those families. God, be with those in this congregation that are dealing with loss, that are mourning the death of someone that they can no longer look up to and spend some time with. God, I pray for all of those who've decided to take an effort to get closer to you in this Lenten season. Be with them as they give them courage to put away distractions from their relationship with you. Or be with them as they're encouraged to do new things to grow closer to you. If they're like the child when they realize that it's not 2 weeks but 6 weeks, that you realize that it's worth the struggle and anything to get to know you is worth the time. God, I pray for all of those who are traveling for spring break. I ask you to give rest for the teachers that are finally getting breaks and for those breaks who are just a couple weeks away. God, I know that my church family has certain prayers and concerns. I ask for you to be with this church as we lift those up to you. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for being in this room here with us. And thank you for being with us as we leave. But before we finish praying, let us end our time of praying by saying the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day.
can see over the podium. And, Pastor Clay, the box is for rent in case you need elevation. Good morning, church family. My name's Michelle Noble. I normally attend the first service, so if you don't know who I am, now you do. Our scripture is from the book of Joshua in the Old Testament, chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. And if you would like to follow along in your pew Bible, you can find it on page 194 in the Old Testament. God's commission to Joshua. After the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant, saying, "My servant Moses is dead. Now proceed to cross the Jordan, you and all this people, into the land that I am giving to them, to the Israelites. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, I have given to you, as I promised to Moses. From the wilderness and the Lebanon, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, to the great sea in the west, shall be your territory. No one shall be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you or forsake you. Be strong and courageous, for you shall put this people in possession of the land that I swore to their ancestors to give them. Only be strong and very courageous, being careful to act in accordance with all the law that my servant Moses commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, so that you may be successful wherever you go." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Anytime, Pastor Clay.
I love that we all have such a great sense of humor. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, as we revisit some of our accounts on holy ground, walking in the footsteps where Jesus walked. And as we tell those stories this morning, we pray, O God, that you would continue to enlighten us, to encourage us, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. This summer, I don't think we've set the exact dates yet, but close. Pastor Allen, Pastor Clay, and myself thought we might like to do a sermon series on bucket lists, because that's kind of become an in thing, and some of us have those things. We never called them bucket lists before, but now we do. You know, things we want to do, people we want to see, places we want to go. And I have to tell you that visiting Israel, the Holy Land, was never on my bucket. It was never a part of anything I wanted to do. Up until about a year and a half ago, as we began to put this together and it began to gel very well, this trip to Israel, and we wound up going with 18 people from this congregation, actually 22 from our group, and another 24 people from Johnson City and Blanco. And it's hard to describe what we saw, what we heard, and how we felt. I love this text of God telling Joshua, when you cross the Jordan River and you enter the land that I have left for you, for your people to come, your families, that everywhere you put your foot, I think the text, every place that the sole of your feet touches, I'm giving to you. And that was 1,400 years before Jesus walked in those same places that now, 2,000 years later, that we got to walk. This morning we have several folks who are going to talk to us and show pictures of our trip. That's kind of the sermon today, is a travelogue. In our first service this morning, Susan Tope and Nancy Campbell and Liz Shelton talked about their experiences, and now in this service, we're Going to hear from Steve and Marianne Gardner, from Bill and Jeannette Pickard, and from Jack and Caroline Ragsdill. And I think that Steve and Marianne are starting us off. Is that right?
Yep.
Okay.
I'm going to go over my face and don't trip.
Yeah. Here's a pointer if you need it for any of your pictures.
Okay. You said I have to point this way, wouldn't
you? You have to get behind the mic, Steve.
Yes,
we want you to come to the podium behind the mic. Please.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, Marianne, you want to describe this one?
Actually, that was, we were on the Sea of Galilee, and you can see the two flags, the Israel and the American flag, and that's our whole group that went.
Okay, well, my background's an engineer, one, and two, I just like maps. So when I go and travel somewhere, I like to know where I've been and what I've seen. And this kind of gives you where Israel is located. And you probably already knew where it was, but when you start to go there and walk around and see the place, it becomes more real. And you realize how small Israel is, and yet how much impact it had on the history of the world that followed. Israel is only 270 miles long and 71 miles wide. And yet it was kind of the center of where everybody traveled. If you came from Europe to go to Africa or those countries down there, you had to go through Israel. Anywhere you went, it was kind of a crossroads, so there was always battles and everything going on about that region. They were constant. Whoever controlled that area basically controlled the world. So anyway, that's the history of that. Move on.
You can move it yourself.
Can I move it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can.
Okay. Another thing that becomes interesting, you hear about the Palestinians and the Israelis and all the fighting. Well, when you get over there, you see that the areas in green are actually the Palestinian areas, and the country or the region of Palestine is actually inside of Israel, and it's walled off from the rest of the world. So it's if you want to leave there and you're a Muslim, you can't go through Israel. You have to go out over the Jordan River, and it's hard to get in and out. So you can see it's pretty well protected and fortified. And this one, before we move on, that little circle is a little out of shape here, but what amazed me is Jesus's world, where he roamed, is only about 70 miles long and about 25 miles wide. So the impact Jesus had on the world, how he changed our religion, how God changed everything through that effort, through that small region, just kind of really starts to sink in when you see it. What this is, each day we had a different trip, and I'm going to briefly kind of go over it, but this is our first full day of traveling, and we got to go to the Dead Sea. We went to where the scroll, Dead Sea scrolls were found. John the Baptist, where John was baptized.
Jesus
was baptized. And all the way back to the Jericho and the Wadi Kilt, which is kind of a almost like looking kind of small Grand Canyon where Jesus walked to go back and forth.
Between Jericho and Bethany.
And, you know, I've heard the phrase in the Bible, though he walked through the shadow of death, valley of death, he will fear no evil. That's where it came from, walking through that valley. All those phrases started to have more meaning to me because we had actually been there and seen those things. And it made a lot of sense. You got to see Jericho. We didn't see the walls tumble down, but we did see what was left of a little while. I'm going to briefly hit this one, but Bill and Jeanette Pickard are going to be discussing this one. This is the Sea of Galilee, and this is where Jesus performed a lot of miracles. Another thing I found interesting is, to me, sea is a big body of water. You know, I always think of sea as something you've got huge ships on. Well, the Sea of Galilee is only 16 miles long, and it's about 7 miles wide, so it's not even bigger than Lake Travis. So it's, I wonder why they call it a sea, but that's the name they gave to it. Okay. Okay, this is day six where you got to go see Jacob's Well. That was one of the inspiring sights for Marianne. I know that they're good.
I just thought it was pretty cool to be at a place where so many of our ancestors had walked, and it was like over 3,500 years old, and it was not what they called a tradition. They knew that was Jacob's Well.
And you could lower a bucket down into it and pull the bucket up and drink that water. In fact, you got some and brought it back with us. So it, that's pretty much an inspiring moment. This is kind of a,
just skip that one.
Let's skip that one. Go ahead and start.
That was, this was at the Jordan River, and it was really amazing, and to just be able to get down and touch the water where Jesus was baptized was just, I can't explain how it felt. It was just amazing. And then we renewed our baptism there with Tommy and Carlos and Lee Romero, so it was really neat.
One of the things we did do is take a boat ride on the Sea of Galilee. We did it early in the morning because in the afternoon waves pick up and it's too rough to go out. So riding on the Sea of Galilee and seeing how the winds came up and blew up the sea and where Jesus walked out on the water.
Those are interesting.
Okay, well, we'll leave it at that then.
Thank you very much.
I too love maps, and Steve helped put a lot of that into perspective for me later as I saw those. Could we back up a slide, please? And one more back. Good. I received a series of pictures from Bill and Jeannette to include. This was not one of them. I put this in there to surprise Jeannette. This is her, of course, kneeling at the Jordan River, where we relived our baptism and where we celebrated. So, Jeannette and Bill, if you would come up now at this time, and because your slides, and you know where they go to where there's, yeah. Hey, you guys are great.
That's a good picture.
Yeah. I had that one. I couldn't resist putting it in there.
My favorite is you holding the lamp.
Yeah. If you want to use it or not, it's okay.
I don't let it go.
Okay, go for it.
I don't know what next. Is that the Jordan? No.
No, that's the lake.
I need to go back, but I don't know how to do that.
Can you go back? Take it back to the Jordan, por favor. One more.
I can't.
One more. There you go. Yeah. There you go.
Okay, so on this day, the first thing we did was go to the Jordan, I think.
Mm-mm.
No. Never mind. Anyway, we went to the Jordan. The bus stopped. We got off of the bus, and we're walking down, and there it was. The place where Jesus walked down, and where John said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." I went, "Oh my goodness. I'm walking on this ground, this holy ground." And then when we knelt down and touched the water, touched the rocks, I could almost see Jesus walking there and see Jesus in that and John baptizing him. And it was just a really, it was a special time for me. And then Tommy, the other pastors did it also. Mary Ann mentioned this, that Tommy took some water and put it on our faces and asked us to remember our baptism. He did this individually, though, and for me it was very special to remember our baptism and remember the call God has on our lives. So it was just an amazing time at the Jordan for me.
All right, we'll move to the Sea of Galilee now. One of the things about the Sea of Galilee is it was the only place that I personally recall where Jesus was asked to leave after performing a miracle. And that was when he drove out the demons from the man that roamed the graves at Gennesaret. He healed the demons, and he asked the demons who they were, and they said, "We are legion, for there are many." And he drove them out and drove them into a herd of swine, and then the herd of swine ran down and drowned in the lake, the sea, lake. And the people of the town said, "Leave us, because we're afraid of you. And you've done a lot to hurt our economy by killing all those hogs." Of course, the Jewish people didn't think much of hogs anyway. But that was the one time that I can recall that Jesus was asked to leave the area after doing marvelous things. The other thing that I think is important about the Sea of Galilee is it's the only large lake that's fresh water in that whole little country. And for a long time, it was basically all they had for fresh water supply. Now, because of the growth in population and some treaties with the surrounding countries where they have to supply some fresh water to them, they've been forced to go to salination technologies, and there are several of those. I don't know which one exactly they use, but I would hope it's not evaporation and condensation. That's a very expensive one. Probably reverse osmosis, which is pushing the water through and keeping the minerals behind. But I was interested in the size. As Steve said, it's a very small lake, and I wanted to think about it in terms of another lake in the United States. And because we lived in Orange for a long time and we're familiar with the Toledo Bend Reservoir, which is on the Sabine River, I took a look at that. And it's amazing that a lake as small in diameter and length and width as the Sea of Galilee is could provide the as much fresh water as they have for that whole country. I think Steve mentioned that the Sea of Galilee was like, 13 miles long and 8 miles wide. Toledo Bend is 65 miles long and 10 miles wide. But the surface area of the Sea of Galilee is 64 square miles, and the surface area of Toledo Bend is 289 square miles. So there's a huge difference. And if you're a bass fisherman, you probably know where Toledo Bend is, because it's famous for its bass fishing. Let's see. Oh, the other thing that was of interest is the shoreline. The shoreline length of Toledo Bend is 1,264 miles, and where is it? Shoreline for the sea is 33 miles. So you can see that Toledo Bend takes up a lot more water. The other interesting thing that I found was that the Sea of Galilee has had a lot of different names throughout history. It's been called Sea of Menya way back yonder. It's been called the Sea of Gennesaret, Sea of Galilee. It kind of depended on who was in power and doing the name calling, what they call it. There was a Jewish name that I can't pronounce off the top of my head. It's a very important piece of Israel's history and of Israel's current water supply demands. Thank you.
I just want to add a little bit to the Sea of Galilee. When we were on that boat and you looked out, and when we were there, it was just this peaceful, beautiful place. And I could picture Jesus asleep on that boat. I could also picture him walking toward, on the water, toward the disciples on the boat. And Peter jumping out of that boat and headed toward him. And we were told how fast a storm can come up. And it just occurred to me that the storms come up in our lives pretty fast too. And all we have to do is call on the name of Jesus and he calms that storm. And also at the Kairos weekend, there was a picture on the podium of Jesus reaching out his hand to Peter as he was sinking. How many times have I been sinking? And he just reaches out his hand and pulls us to safety and calms the storm. And that's what struck me at the Sea of Galilee.
Thank you. Thank you all. That was really... Thank you.
We're here.
Jack and Caroline, come on up. I don't know where we are in the slides, whether we've gotten to yours yet or not, or if there are a couple more.
We haven't.
But we'll just go through and you tell them where to stop.
There you go.
Okay, just keep going. Stop.
I'm gonna take the first word here. I'll never get any more words in. But, Carolyn will tell you all about the pictures you're gonna see. I was taking these pictures and not really thinking about where we were and what's happened there, so she'll tell you that. But I did have a good experience trying to swim in the Dead Sea. You probably heard about it. It's got a lot of salt in it. That's the only thing that can live in it is salt, and that's what they get from there. But you cannot sink yourself. You cannot drown. It's just like the beach at the Galveston or any beach. There's waves coming in. You can't avoid the stinging salt getting your eyes or the nasty taste of it. So that was the experience that I had.
Okay, I'm going to talk today about the Via Dolorosa, also known, excuse me, as the Way of the Cross. Just a minute. It's one of the holiest sites in Christendom. It's the route that Jesus took from the place of his trial to the place of his crucifixion. There are 14 stations along the way, 9 outside where we went, and then 5 inside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. The walk was over 3 miles and on uneven ground. Go to the next one. It's hard to see, but... And very steep at times. There you go. That's more like it. You walked a little. You went upstairs. You walked a little more. It was narrow. There were shops on each side that had kind of garage doors that they opened up. But anyway, there is a tradition for pilgrims to walk the same walk and carry the cross of Jesus. And we encountered some people doing that along the way. Taking on the cross, they said, started about the 4th century when people would reenact Jesus' steps. And then station 1, Jesus is condemned to death. And in station 2, he is flogged by the Roman soldiers and then the thorn of crowns placed on his head when he takes up the cross. At station 3, which is the next one, you can kind of see him there. This is where he falls the first time under the burden of the cross. And then we'll skip to station 5, is where Jesus is helped by Simon of Cyrene, who came to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. So he just happened to be there, and then he helped Jesus as he walked by. In station 6, Veronica wipes Jesus' face, her house. Go back one. Well, yeah, I don't know where it is. Anyway, Veronica wipes Jesus' face. Her house was on the walk, and as he walked by, she emerged and she wiped the sweat of his brow with her handkerchief, and his image was imprinted on it. Then on station 8, Jesus is met with the daughters of Jerusalem who were crying over his bitter fate. And he told them, "Do not weep for me, rather for yourselves and for your children." And then Jesus falls the third time. And this is where he is taken to what is now the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. Of course, it wasn't there back then. He is stripped of his clothes and is nailed to the cross by the Roman soldier. The next one. The Church of the Holy Sepulchre was built by Constantine the Great during the 4th century when he became a Christian. And he made Christianity the official religion. It was damaged by fire and rebuilt, but today it is managed through a complicated arrangement from the Greek Orthodox Church, the Catholic Church, and the Armenians. As you can see from the very plain outside, but it is very ornate inside. Inside is the Calvary Hill or Golgotha. Can you point where he's hanging on the cross? Point it with your pointer. Oh, sorry, I'm looking over here and I'm not seeing it. Okay, yes, that's it, yes. Sorry about that. Okay, that's Golgotha or Calvary Hill, which means skull, because the hill was in the shape of a skull. And tradition points to this exact place where Jesus' cross was placed. The rock, the actual rock of Calvary, it was under that altar encased in glass. And there was a hole in the altar. Go to the next one. It's kind of blurry. There's this big plate, and in the center was a hole.
Cross.
And you could reach down and touch the rock. Then Jesus' body was taken down from the cross. And just inside the entrance of the church is called the Stone of Anointment, a big slab there, which tradition claims that this was the spot where Mary and Joseph of Arimathea prepared Jesus' body for burial. There are murals on the walls depicting the scenes of when they removed his body and preparing it for burial. There are several different scenes that are beautiful. After Christ was taken down from the cross and his body anointed, he was buried in a tomb donated by Joseph of Arimathea. When the church was built on this site, then some 300 years later, they took away all of the, you can go to the next one, they took away all of the part around the tomb and just left a very small part. They chipped away all the big rock around. So this is what they put over it. It's ornate shrine, but in the very center is where there's a door where you go in to the tomb. And there are two chambers. I think one is kind of like for preparation of the body and then the actual burial spot. But it was very hard to see, and we were very fortunate in that we just had to wait about 20 minutes, but they said sometimes you have to wait 2 hours. So there's people milling around, and it was hard to get a real picture, but right there in the center is just a hole where you walked inside. The Greek Orthodox, the Catholic, and the Armenians all have rites to the tomb, and they all three have celebrate Mass there daily. This is one of two alleged burial sites. The other site is called the Garden Tomb, and it's located outside the city walls. There we go. And this is more like what I picture it, you know, just out in the wilderness with the, you know, the rock caves. This is what I picture it to be. You see that little doorway there? This is our group. And we could go in. Again, it was a two-chamber tomb. So both of them claim to be the site. So you just... But there were so many, then the next slide. This is our group at the very end. We're still at that garden. And that's our three pastors who went with us, and we're celebrating communion. And they gave each one of us a little olive wood goblet for our communion wine. It was very special. The But there were so many wonderful sites, as I mentioned, Jacob's Well, the Wailing Wall, Peter's House, the place where John the Baptist was born, the remains of Solomon's Temple, the site of the Dead Sea Scrolls. There was so much to see that it was overwhelming. But I think all of us who went can agree that we will never read the Bible quite the same again after having actually been there and seen some of the sites where it took place. So, thank you.
That's really true. I don't think I can ever read some pages, both Old and New Testament, without seeing an image of what we experienced there. And I want to thank you all for participating, for helping. And there are several, there's others here in the room who also went with us. Jimmy and Betty are here, and Elsie's here. I don't want to leave off any of them, but there's a group of us that went, and I want to do it again. Probably won't happen for a while, but I will carry with me as I now read and study, as I pray, I will carry with me a much deeper appreciation for the place and the time that Jesus lived, what he did, what he said, and how much that means to me today and impacts on me today. And I think I speak for all of us. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the opportunities you give us in life to learn more about you. Some are not, oh God, as all-encompassing as this, but Lord, we take what you give us. And from this trip, we take, oh God, the closeness we felt to you and carry it with us. Help us, oh God, to tell others more thoroughly and with more fervor about the Jesus, the Son of God, who lived there and died there for us and for the forgiveness of sins. And this we pray in his name. Amen. As we get ready to sing our next hymn, if there are those who would like to come and kneel at the rail, we would be glad to receive you and to pray with you if you would like. And if you would like to come and join our fellowship this morning, summons part of this congregation, please come as we sing our final hymn.